Hi, Mr. Androstic here on vacation in Washington, D.C., and I decided to record the introduction for our next presentation in front of the White House because the topic of the presentation is John Adams' presidency. John Adams was the first president to live in the White House, so it seems like a fitting place to do this introduction. Now, what we're going to do in this presentation is we're going to look at some of the highlights as well as some of the lowlights of John Adams' presidency.
To begin with, let's take a look at a short video biography on the early years of John Adams.
John Adams, our second president. John Adams was born in this modest salt box house near Boston, but John Adams' life was to be anything but modest. Unlike George Washington, who was mainly self-taught, John Adams had an excellent formal education. He entered Harvard College in 1751, where he studied law. He mastered the profession and began a successful law practice. Adams was a Massachusetts delegate to the 1774 Continental Congress, held here in Carpenter's Hall in Philadelphia. He helped draft the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. Adams was named our first vice president under George Washington and succeeded him as our second president. John Adams was the first to live in the White House. Although his own presidency was a troubled one, he was an honest man who personified the best of what the nation could hope for in its leaders. He retired to his home in what is now Quincy, Massachusetts, and died there on July 4th, 1826, at the age of 90.
John Adams had been vice president to George Washington. On the contrary, Thomas Jefferson had been Washington's first Secretary of State. Both positions made Adams and Jefferson excellent candidates to be the second president. By the time Washington was leaving office, political parties were forming, much to the chagrin of Washington. Thomas Jefferson was the leader of the new Democratic Republicans, often just called Republicans for short. John Adams was one of the leading Federalists, the other party to form. In the 1796 election, John Adams was the winner. But there was a bit of a catch. The original procedure for electing president in the Constitution called for the runner-up to become vice president. The drafters of the Constitution hadn't thought of such an issue arising, especially since there were no political parties when it was written. But in 1796, that meant Thomas Jefferson won the vice presidency. Can you see the problem here? The president and vice president were of opposing parties. That would be like, in the 2012 election, Barack Obama winning the presidency, but Mitt Romney becoming his vice president. The two did not have a very friendly or working relationship. Soon thereafter, Congress saw the problem, and steps were taken to prevent this from happening in the future. In 1804, the 12th Amendment was ratified, which called for the Electoral College to elect the president and vice president separately, and the age of running mates was born. As with Washington, Adams had his own unique set of challenges that he had to address during his presidency. Adams only served one term, but he packed a lot of controversy into those 4 years. Adams had to manage foreign affairs in his own way, deal with problems within his own political party, as well as problems involving states' rights, and handle the backlash that came with the Alien and Sedition Acts, which we'll talk about. First, let's talk about foreign affairs. If you'll recall, France had been at war with Britain, and Washington declared the United States neutral with his Neutrality Proclamation in 1793. We also mentioned that Jay's Treaty mostly settled the issues that we had with Britain, involving the capture of U.S. ships, forts in the Ohio River Valley, and debts that we owed to Britain. But when we settled our issues with Britain, France was angry to see us being cordial with Britain, and so they began to seize American ships the same way the British had been doing. Adams sent three ambassadors to France to negotiate a treaty with French Foreign Minister Charles Maurice de Talleyrand. Talleyrand, instead, would not be meeting directly with the ambassadors, but he sent agents to tell the American ambassadors that the only way the attacks on U.S. ships would stop was if the United States both gave money to Talleyrand personally and loaned France $10 million. $10 million. The Americans refused, saying, "Not a sixpence." When news got back to the U.S. of the incident, Americans were outraged. Some said, "Millions for defense, but not 1 cent for tribute," and pushed for war with France. Many Americans felt completely disrespected by the French behavior, and that's why they wanted war. Adams didn't give in to the idea of having war. He also didn't pay up. But what he did start doing was putting money into the American Navy to build it up, make it stronger, and to be able to defend our ships on the high seas. Our willingness to build up our military to possibly fight France was enough for France to stop attacking ships. And Talleyrand sent a message to John Adams, assuring him that he would treat the Americans with respect going forward. Oh, and I should mention why they called it the XYZ Affair. When John Adams reported to Congress about the behavior of Talleyrand and his agents, he didn't divulge the names of the agents. He simply referred to them as X, Y, and Z. I know it's kind of a boring story for how the name came about, but what are you going to do? The Federalists were split in their opinions on the situation with France, and their differences of opinion caused the party to begin falling apart. You may have noticed there aren't really any Federalists now, right? Well, this is the beginning of the end for them back in the 1700s. They had one president, they lasted about 10 years, and then the party died out. The conflict with France had a different Federalist than John Adams, a guy by the name of Alexander Hamilton, calling for war with France. He thought the war would not only move the country in the direction of a strong federal government, but it would also weaken Thomas Jefferson's Republicans because the nation would support a president who was at war. Adams wasn't willing to go to war for the political leverage, and the party split. Hamilton and his followers went off on their own and became known as the High Federalists. Adams later sent ambassadors to France to negotiate a second time, but by then they were ruled by Napoleon Bonaparte, who wanted to avoid war with the United States, and he agreed to stop seizing ships. That agreement is called the Convention of 1800. Adams continued the Washington strategy of avoiding war, but it cost him his party support and eventually the next election. What also didn't help Adams in the 1800 election was the backlash that came from the Alien and Sedition Acts. Now, the Alien and Sedition Acts were passed by the High Federalists in Congress, not by Adams alone. And while the Federalists thought of them as a national security measure, deep down, the acts were also a political strategy. The acts did a number of things. First, they allowed the president to deport foreigners that he thought to be dangerous. Secondly, it extended the time necessary for an immigrant to live here in the United States before being eligible for citizenship. It used to take 5 years of residency in the country before citizenship could be granted. Now it was going to take 14 years. High Federalists claimed that these measures were needed to prevent espionage in the United States, that is, spying. However, as many immigrants were French, they would naturally be supporters of the Republicans, and these acts would keep them from voting for many years, which would hurt the Republican Party. The final measure of the acts was the Sedition Act. Sedition means to incite rebellion against the government. But the act declared that anyone who even criticized the government could be jailed. And there were journalists, often and usually Republicans, who were jailed as a result of the Sedition Act. Again, claiming for it to be national security, the Federalists had found a way to outlaw criticism of their party, since the Federalists were in power, and that would again hopefully weaken the Republican Party. But doesn't this violate the First Amendment's right to freedom of speech, press, and petition? Many people at the time thought so, and most historians today believe that it did as well. The Alien and Sedition Acts faced backlashes from people all over the country, and one of the biggest arguments against them, or one of the biggest arguments used against them, was the argument of states' rights. Throughout our history, there has been a power struggle between state and federal governments. Which one should have more power? Jefferson argued that the states should have more power to run themselves than the federal government does, and called on states to nullify or cancel the federal laws that they disagreed with. The argument was that since the Alien and Sedition Acts were unfair and perhaps unconstitutional, that states could simply choose to ignore them and go about their business their own way. Virginia and Kentucky were the two states that led the way with this attitude, Jefferson's of Virginia. They passed resolutions stating that they would not obey the Alien and Sedition Acts, and they provided justification for why they could do this. While Jefferson was probably right about the laws being kind of bogus, was he right that the states could ignore them? What do you think? And that's setting a dangerous precedent for the state to be able to ignore the federal law. That'd be like a child being able to ignore a parent's decisions. That could lead to some big issues later on. But either way, the laws were dropped after a few years and things went back to normal. But the issue of states' rights would play a role in American history from that point on. Still does today. Wow, wow, wow. Wow. All the controversy surrounding Adams was more than he could overcome in the 1800 election. In 1800, he ran against Thomas Jefferson again, and this time the Republicans were much more popular with the voters. The split in the Federalist Party meant Adams didn't even have his own party on his side, and the Alien and Sedition Acts, combined with increased taxes to pay for the military, left more Americans disappointed with Adams. Things were so bad for Adams that the Republicans actually ran two candidates, hoping that both would beat Adams and one would become vice president. And they were successful. Thomas Jefferson won the election, and Aaron Burr was the runner-up, and he became vice president. Remember, the running mates thing didn't exist until 1804, so that's how they had to get the president and the vice president, was by running two candidates. Because Adams finished third, he was out of the executive office altogether. This election spelled the end of the Federalists, and from that point on, they would never have another party member elected president. Take a look at these review questions. If you can answer these based on what we saw in the presentation, then you know your John Adams history. Don't forget to go back and look at the PowerPoint version of this presentation. Be sure to click the links in it that you see to access some other videos that will help fill in the gaps of the history of John Adams that I no doubt left. We'll see you next time.